Good evening, everyone. Welcome to California State University of Monterey Bay, the President Speaker Series. My name is Joe Cardinelli. I'm with the World Theater and the Performing Arts Series. And before we start and bring out Diane Ravitch and Diane Harrison, we have to do a little of the state business. I have to just remind everybody of the exits in the building. So in case of an emergency, the lights will come up and there are exits left and right of the auditorium, and the ushers will help you out of the building. This is the time to turn off your cell phones. And there you go, everybody's reaching for pagers, Blackberries. We ask that there's no texting during the presentation because a big beam of light shows and we can actually see your face. And there's no photography or flash photography or recording devices allowed. In your programs, there's a little 3x5 card, and part of the presentation after Diane Ravitch's speech, there's a question and answer period. And if you'd like to write down your question on that card, the ushers will pick them up, and then they'll bring them up on stage for Ms. Ravitch to answer. A couple other little quick things is that we're also being recorded for NPR Radio tonight on KAZU, our own station, right? Okay. And it'll be recorded, it'll be played at a later date, and then we're also being videotaped by the school here, and for students, the tape will be available at the library if you'd like to take a look at it, or if you'd like your class to take a look at it, it'll be available. So we are being recorded. I think I got all the messages down, but before we start, and before we bring on Diane Harrison, the president, what we do for our radio audience is we start an applause going, because that applause brings the radio station in. So are we ready backstage? And I'm going to have Phil as my helper here. Give a hand to Phil. There you go. See, that gets it started. Okay. So let's keep the applause going. Welcome to California State University of Monterey Bay. I'd like to introduce our president, Ms. Diane Harrison.
Good evening, everyone. And welcome to the third event in our 2010-11 President Speaker Series. I'm very pleased to welcome all of you tonight and to have the honor of introducing our speaker, Dr. Diane Ravitch. Dr. Ravitch is a research professor of education at New York University and a historian of education. In addition, she is a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. From 1991 to 1993, she was Assistant Secretary of Education and Counselor to Secretary of Education Lamar Alexander in the administration of President George H.W. Bush. She was responsible for the Office of Educational Research and Improvement in the U.S. Department of Education. As Assistant Secretary, she led the federal effort to promote the creation of voluntary state and national academic standards. She is the author of 10 books on the American educational system, including her most recent work, The Death and Life of the Great American School System, How Testing and Choice Are Undermining Education, which was published in 2010. She's also edited 14 books. She shares a blog called Bridging Differences with Deborah Meyer, hosted by Education Week. She also blogs for Politico.com and the Huffington Post, also known as HuffPo. I just learned that a couple weeks ago. Her articles have appeared in many newspapers and magazines. Dr. Ravitch has lectured widely around the world, particularly in Eastern Europe, and her views on democracy and civic education have been translated into many languages. A native of Houston, Dr. Ravitch is a graduate of the Houston Public School System. She received a BA from Wellesley College in 1960 and a PhD from Columbia in History from Columbia University's Graduate School of Arts and Sciences in 1975. Dr. Ravitch joins us tonight as a scholar and social observer who has actively engaged in the great national debate over public education. She is a respected voice in a discussion that concerns us all. How can we best improve the education America's children receive in grades K through 12. And, I think she would add, are we investing in the right solutions to ensure that students graduate high school prepared to successfully enter post-secondary education or in the workforce? And those of us in university systems, particularly in the CSU, know that far too many of our students come unprepared to do college-level work. And so they must undertake remedial work, which puts them behind. So we're all interested in this. We all want solutions that will help us and our children. Dr. Ravitch's appearance this evening comes at a very crucial time as Congress prepares to decide whether to reauthorize the federal No Child Left Behind Act in the coming year. Dr. Ravitch acknowledges her own evolving views about such tools as standardized testing and such strategies as No Child Left Behind, of which she is now a vocal critic. She has eschewed a reliance on narrow-gauge approaches such as charter schools, which she contends have shown mixed results and are far from a panacea. She objects to the amount of blame being directed at teachers in struggling schools and a generally punitive approach to school reform. And she believes experts and policymakers should instead focus on the root social causes of low student achievement. Without a doubt, Dr. Ravitch is a speaker well suited to the objective of this lecture series, and that is, we hope to provoke thought, we hope to provoke discussion, and bring important perspectives to our audience. So we are delighted to have her with us this evening. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Diane Ravitch.
Thank you very much, President Harrison. It is wonderful to be here in Monterey Bay. A little cooler than I would have liked, but it's beautiful nonetheless, and I'm very happy to be with you. It's certainly a very dramatic and crucial moment in the history of American public education. I have to say that all the years that I've been both a participant and a student of American education, I have never seen the kinds of crises that surround us today. We hear critics every day who say that our public schools are failing. They point to mediocre scores on international tests and to the achievement gap between students of different races. And they say that these low scores are the fault of bad teachers. And they say that we must fire bad teachers, we must fire principals, we must close schools. They say that the public schools should be replaced by privately managed charter schools, and that the private sector will certainly be more successful than the public sector. Well, as I've written over the years, my focus has been about controversy in public education. We've always had critics. Going well back into the 19th century, our schools have always had critics. But the critics wanted better teachers, better standards, better curriculum. They wanted more funding. They wanted more equitable funding. They wanted an end to racial segregation. What they didn't want, though, was an end to public education. There has never been so much criticism directed at educators and at public schools as there is today. And so today our schools face what I call a perfect storm. First, there is this terrible economy in which many thousands of teachers are facing layoffs. And then we have added to that the effects of No Child Left Behind, which has now been the law of the land since it was signed in January of 2002, and that law has the utopian goal that 100% of students will be proficient by the year 2014, or schools will be punished if they fail to meet that target or be on track to meet that target. And then the third part of this perfect storm is race to the top. Race to the top, the Obama administration program has dangled billions of federal dollars before the states to persuade them to adopt unproven reforms. And I'll be talking about that this evening. For the past year, the media has celebrated this idea that education should be treated like a business. and that if the test scores are low, then fire the teachers, close the schools, start over. Almost a year ago, Newsweek had a headline on one of its covers, and it said, "The Key to Saving American Education." And on that cover, behind the headline, was written again, 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 "We must fire bad teachers, we must fire bad teachers," that being the key to saving American education. So there is today this reform movement, which I call the corporate reform movement. And the greatest coup for this corporate reform movement was a film, which you may have heard of, called Waiting for Superman. NBC last September devoted a week of programming to the movie and to its thesis. They call that week Education Nation. Oprah devoted two of her primetime shows to talking about the movie and celebrating it. Time magazine gave it a cover story, and on it went. Many people assumed that because the director of the movie had previously won an Academy Award for a film, a documentary about global warming, that this was a liberal movie. But it was not a liberal movie. The money behind it was not at all liberal. One of the producers was previously the CEO of a chain of for-profit post-secondary institutions, and the other is an evangelical billionaire who invests heavily in pro-privatization, pro-voucher think tanks. And this movie reflected that point of view. The storyline of the movie, it was very simple. Public education is rotten. We should feel sorry for the poor kids who have to go to public schools. And the central fact of the movie, or non-fact of the movie, was its claim that 70% of our eighth graders read below grade level. And so the movie said that the reason for this terrible performance, which it showed as a national problem, is that there are so many bad teachers and they're protected by bad unions. And the movie had its solutions. The commentators, few of whom were educators, said, "We know what works. Testing and accountability works. Merit pay works. Privately managed charter works. Eliminating teachers' due process rights works so that they can be easily fired." It also said that private entrepreneurs, when they run schools, get amazing results. If you listen closely, you would hear the director say, actually only one out of five gets amazing results. But nonetheless, the movie insists that we need many more such schools. Well, this widely publicized movie mixes fact and fiction, and it advocates for privatization and for deprofessionalization. The central falsehood in the movie is the claim that 70% of our eighth graders or below grade level in reading. The source of this claim is the national testing statistics coming from, there's something called the National Assessment of Educational Progress. As it happens, I was appointed by President Clinton to the board of the National Assessment and was a member of that board for 7 years, from 1997 to 2004, and I know the statistics quite well. It's not 70% that are below grade level, it's 25%. So it was a little mistake like that. 25%, and that 25% includes many children who are English language learners and children with various kinds of disabilities. It would be wonderful if every student were a proficient reader, but it's simply false to assert that most middle school students are below grade level. It's not true. So Waiting for Superman makes the bold assertion that resources don't matter and that poverty doesn't matter. And to prove these points, the filmmaker singles out Jeffrey Canada's Harlem Children's Zone and says it gets amazing results. But Harlem Children's Zone does not prove either point, quite to the contrary. The Harlem Children's Zone offers, its purpose is to offer an array of very richly funded anti-poverty programs, including medical services, social services, parenting classes, pre-kindergarten classes, after-school classes. It also has two charter schools. Its charter schools spend far more than the regular public schools in the neighborhood, and they have smaller classes. In most of its classes, there are 15 students in a class with two teachers. Just like in California, right? And students who fall behind get one-to-one tutoring. The Harlem Children's Zone is gifted with a super-rich board of trustees that includes at least two billionaires. It has $200 million in private assets for the zone. Apparently, the lesson that I take from this is that resources don't matter if you have them. When you don't have them, they matter a lot. But even all of these advantages have not been enough to completely vanquish the effects of poverty. Jeffrey Canada gathered his students for his first year in his charter school from the neighborhood. He didn't select, he just gathered in kids and said, I'm starting a charter school. I'm calling my school the Harlem Promise Academy because I promise you that if you enroll in my school, you will go to college. And the first group was in sixth grade and they had low test scores. And in seventh grade, their test scores didn't go up much. And in eighth grade, they remained too low for his board of trustees, which found it embarrassing. And Jeffrey Canada called them together and said, you're all out of here. He threw the whole class out. So he was able to focus in future years on getting some of his students to produce better test scores to please his board. And now half of his students meet state standards, half don't. This is better than the neighborhood public schools, but I'm willing to bet the neighborhood public schools would do just as well if they had the same resources. Another charter school that the movie holds up as a model is called the Seed Boarding School. It's a charter school in Washington, D.C. The movie doesn't mention that tuition at this school is $35,000 per year per student. So yes, resources do matter. And as I was working on a review of the movie for the New York Review of Books, and you can Google it, it's interesting review because the one thing I missed, though, was that I looked at the website for the Seed Charter School. I saw that it had been featured on 60 Minutes, and the website said that 96% of its graduates go on to college. So I was impressed, and I said, well, it's expensive, but apparently it gets great results. What I didn't realize was what I learned a few days after my review was published, and that is that a parent activist sent me a page off the U.S. Department of Education's website showing the attrition rate at the Seed Charter School. 140 students begin in seventh grade, and last June, 34 graduated. That's a 75% attrition rate. And of that, 25% that survived, 96% went on to college. But that's an improvement, because a few years ago, of 140, only 13 persisted, which is a 90% attrition rate. So whenever you hear stories about miracle schools, bear in mind that Hollywood loves miracles, but only God can make a miracle. The corporate reform movement wants educators to use business methods. Educators tend to speak of developing children's character and their love of learning. Corporate reformers look at schools and they measure their productivity and their return on investment. So what I will suggest to you this evening is that the corporate reform consensus is wrong, that it's based on ideology, not on evidence, and that it's fiscally irresponsible to promote strategies that have no evidence, and that the corporate reformers are demoralizing millions of teachers and doing harm to American public education. The corporate reformers say that our public education system is a failure, and they say, well, look at the performance on these international tests. We're only in the middle. How awful is it that we got beaten by Shanghai and by Finland? President Obama and Secretary Duncan say we're facing a Sputnik moment, and even long-term economic decline if we don't adopt the corporate reformer strategies. What the president doesn't know, and what his own Department of Education didn't tell him, is that the test scores of American students were even worse in the 1960s, the 1970s, the 1980s, and the 1990s. We're making progress. We're in the middle now. The Soviet Union launched Sputnik, its satellite Sputnik, in 1957. We did not respond by raising our test scores on international assessments. For the past 50 years, our students were usually either dead last or in the bottom quarter on the international test in math and science. And we're here, the strongest, most powerful nation in the world, and the Soviet Union is not. The president said in his State of the Union address, quote, America still has the largest, most prosperous economy in the world. No workers are more productive than ours. No country has more successful companies or grants more patents to inventors and entrepreneurs. We're home to the world's best colleges and universities where more students come to study than any other place on earth. Well, after he spoke, Professor Yang Zhao, a Chinese-born and Chinese-educated scholar who is now at the University of Oregon, reacted to the president's speech by asking these questions. Who educated these productive workers? Who educated the founders of those successful companies? who educated the inventors and the entrepreneurs, who provided the brain power for the world's best colleges and universities. It must have been that same terrible cohort of students who were in the bottom quartile on those international assessments in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. Well, something must be wrong with the logic. Yang Zhao said, it makes no sense. Or something must be wrong with these international assessments and what we learn from them if these allegedly terrible public schools produce the greatest workers, thinkers, and innovators that created this, the greatest economy in the world. Well, I'm not here to defend the status quo. I think the status quo today in education is truly awful. Our schools need major improvement, but they need improvement based on proven strategies, not radical schemes imposed by non-educators. The status quo today is defined by the federal law called No Child Left Behind. It's been the law of the land now for almost 10 years, and it has compelled educators to focus relentlessly on test scores. This was President George W. Bush's signature program. It was passed with large bipartisan majorities. You may or may not remember this, but at the time it was passed, Congress was talking about, and all the media was talking about, what was called the Texas Miracle. The Texas Miracle was this: by measuring, publishing the results, making people aware that they were far behind or that they should get a reward because they were far ahead, wonderful things happened. Test scores went up, dropout rates went down, graduation rates went up, the achievement gap narrowed. Well, folks, I'm from Texas. Let me tell you what that's called in Texas. It's called a tall tale. On the NAEP, which is the National Assessment of Educational Progress, the reading scores for the state of Texas have been flat from 1998 to 2009. Texas is now spending $200 million and more for basic remediation in college. And just the other day, Mrs. Laura Bush published an editorial, an opinion piece in the Houston Chronicle called Don't Cut the Education Budget, where she said, we can't afford to cut the budget. We're already 46th and 47th and 48th in the nation in math, in literacy, in verbal SAT scores. Whoa, wasn't there a miracle? How did Texas end up at the bottom of the 50 states? There was no miracle. And so we have a federal law that was passed on the basis of something that didn't happen. The philosophy of No Child Left Behind can be summed up in three words: measure and punish, or measure and reward. It has, as I said before, this utopian goal that 100% of children will be proficient by the year 2014. There must be something in the predictions of Nostradamus about the year 2014. But this is a goal that has never been reached by any nation in the world or any state in this country. Its consequence, I don't think it's its purpose, but its consequence has been to delegitimate public education, to create the sense that public education has failed. Imagine if Congress had passed a law saying all of our cities will be crime-free by the year 2014. And if crime doesn't go away, we will begin closing police departments. So we now have this obsessive, compulsive engagement with data. And we have database this and database that and database everything. And people will say, well, you know, the numbers don't lie. Oh, the easiest thing to lie with is numbers. There was a company that had absolutely spectacular numbers. It was called Enron. The numbers looked terrific up until the day it went into bankruptcy. This story can be told again and again about the companies that went down. We all know Madoff's numbers were terrific too. They were lies. So now we're using data to close public schools and turn them over to private management. But here's an axiom: closing public schools is not a school improvement strategy. It's a privatization strategy. Should we close firehouses if there are too many fires in a neighborhood? Should we close police stations in high crime neighborhoods? Should we strip doctors of their licenses if too many patients die? If we did, what doctor would want to be a heart surgeon? It would be far safer to be a dermatologist. None of your patients would ever die. So when you make numbers your goal, you can get the numbers, but at the same time lose sight of the other goals of the organization. This is goal distortion. Higher test scores are not the goal of education. They are an indicator. We should use tests, and I'm not opposed to testing. I'm opposed to the misuse of testing. Tests should be used diagnostically. They should be used to identify how to help students. They should be used to help teachers get better. If there's too much emphasis on test scores, all sorts of bad things happen. For one thing, children learn test-taking skills and not reading or writing or math. And to the extent that test scores are used for accountability, to hand out punishments and rewards, there has been a rise in cheating. There's been a rise in gaming the system. We've seen state scores going up, but we have not seen a similar increase on the national test scores. We've seen graduation rates going up because the law requires it, but we have not seen a similar decline in remediation rates in college. So what do I mean by gaming the system? There are states that have actually lowered the passing mark on the state test. I live in one of those states in New York. The scores in the state went up and up and up while the national scores stayed flat. The city of New York paid out $100 million in bonuses, and none of the scores were genuine. The state finally, after many complaints about the test and grade inflation, they finally called in independent investigators last spring, and the state announced last June that the test scores indeed were vastly inflated. They lowered the scores across the state, and among other things, New York City's miracle disappeared. The pass rates dropped dramatically across the state. New York City had been boasting that the pass rate in reading was 69% of kids ranking proficient. That dropped to 42%. 82% of the kids were supposedly proficient in math. That dropped to 54%. Kids were being lied to because this obsessive reliance on data turned out to be a chimera because the data were not real. And all of this manipulation of test scores was done to try to reach this requirement of 100% proficiency. And it didn't work. No state has come close. The one that came closest was Massachusetts, where half the students were proficient on the national test. That's astonishing. No other state is even close to Massachusetts. Massachusetts is first in the nation, yet half of the public schools in Massachusetts have been identified as failing to meet adequate yearly progress, as failing schools in the most successful state in the nation. There's something wrong with this. No Child Left Behind is a destructive failed education policy. It has narrowed the curriculum. There's so much time spent on testing and getting ready for the state test because they matter so much that there's less time for history or for literature or the arts or civics or science or geography, for foreign languages, even for physical education, especially in schools for the poorest kids where the scores are lowest. There are schools across this country that set aside weeks before the state test just to prepare for the testing. This is not good education. None of the people in Congress would want this for their own children. Why would they want it for other people's children? No Child Left Behind encouraged teaching to the test. It encouraged what I call the arcane art of bubble guessing. This turns out to be a skill that has absolutely no value in the real world. No one will ever pay you to take a standardized test. There were beneficiaries, however. No Child Left Behind has poured billions into the testing industry and into the tutoring industry to prepare for the testing. These are now multi-billion dollar industries. And the results have been meager. The gains on the national test have been quite small, and actually the gains were larger before No Child Left Behind than since it was passed, and the achievement gap remains large. The remedies don't work, the sanctions don't work, and there are no results. So we come to the question of choice. You should know that over the past half century, we've had steady advocacy for vouchers, and we now have vouchers in three districts, in Milwaukee, in Cleveland, and in the District of Columbia. The oldest of these three voucher programs is in Milwaukee. It was established in 1990. So there have been 20 years of vouchers in Milwaukee. In the first 8 years, there were court challenges. There were several thousand kids getting a couple, I'm sorry, 2,000 or 3,000 kids had vouchers in the first 8 years. But since 1998, when the last legal hurdles were dismissed by the courts, Milwaukee's voucher program has taken off. And there are now 20,000 children in Milwaukee in voucher schools, 17,000 in charter schools, and 80,000 in a shrinking public school system. This is a test case of the efficacy of vouchers. They've had now 12, 13 years of an expanded voucher program, 20 years of existence. For years, researchers used to debate whether vouchers were working or not. And some said there were large gains, some said there were no gains, and went back and forth. But now, researchers have reached a consensus. And the consensus is, that students in the voucher schools make no bigger gains than students in the regular public schools. Now, what makes this particularly interesting is that last year, 2009, for the first time, Milwaukee agreed to participate in a special NAEP, which is given to cities. And Los Angeles also participates. Fresno participated this year for the first time. And there are about somewhere around close to 20 cities that are now tested with samples of students. And it's a weighted scientific sample. 2009, Milwaukee kids took reading and math tests in fourth and eighth grade. And the beneficiaries of vouchers are supposedly African-American students in Milwaukee. They scored lower on the NAEP than African-American students in Louisiana, Alabama, and Mississippi. So I would conclude from this that there were no gains for anyone. 20 years of vouchers produced no rising tide, no boats were lifted. All three sectors, the charter being lumped in with the public schools on the NAEP, all three sectors are doing poorly. Well, in response to these findings, voucher supporters now say the test scores were never the point of vouchers. The point was just to offer choice for the sake of choice. So in Milwaukee, parents got a choice amongst equally ineffective public schools, voucher schools, and charter schools, while the public system was undermined. To pour hundreds of millions of dollars into vouchers, or in some places where some governors are talking about giving vouchers to students who are already in private schools, this would cost billions of dollars that they don't have. This is just fiscally irresponsible. So now we move on to the reform of the day, which is charters. The original idea of charters came out in 1988. It came primarily from the president of the American Federation of Teachers, Albert Shanker. And his idea, he was a very brilliant man and he was a good friend of mine, his idea, which he at one point sketched out on a napkin for me, was that supposing, you know, he was very concerned that there were so many children who dropped out, and there were, in addition to the ones who dropped out, there were many kids in school who were obviously very turned off and were going to drop out if they continued on their present course. And he said, supposing that a group of teachers in a school might be able to say to their colleagues, can we get your permission to create a school within a school that's focused specifically on the children who become alienated from learning, on the students who dropped out? We'll go out in the streets, we'll bring them back. We'll try things that are innovative, we'll see what we can do, and we will then, if you just give us this agreement, this charter, we'll come back to you and share what we've learned. We'll collaborate to make public schools better so that you can help the kids before they get turned off. So it sounded like a pretty good idea at the time. He advocated for it at his national convention. He went around the country speaking to his chapters about it. And he was a strong advocate of the idea from 1988 until 1993. And because he wrote a weekly column in the New York Times, you can pinpoint exactly the day or the week or the month when he said, I think I've made a terrible mistake. I think that the private companies are moving in. They see this as an entrepreneurial opportunity, and I don't want to see privatization. And he concluded that charters were becoming no different from vouchers. So today we have over 5,000 charter schools. They enroll about 1.5 million students, maybe 1.6 million at this point. That's less than 4% of the students in the nation. And They range very widely in quality. There are some excellent charter schools. There are charter schools that continue to try to adhere to the original vision of being a school that reaches out to the kids with the greatest needs. But most of the charters are today in the entrepreneurial sector. We now have not just a charter sector, but a charter industry. And the entrepreneurs who have moved into this sector or industry or see themselves not as collaborators with public education, but as competitors. In some cities, they seek to take over public school space. They want to drive the public schools out of business. They want to take over. And even in some places where they're sponsored by people with vast resources, they still want free public space. The media likes to portray them as miracle schools, and there are some that get amazing results, but if you look closely, it's usually because of attrition or skimming or excluding. Charter schools receive public funds, and they're deregulated schools with minimal oversight by public officials. I guess that I used to think deregulation was a great thing up until, I would pinpoint the date, September of 2008. I lost a lot of money in September of 2008, along with the American economy, and I think that deregulation had quite a lot to do with that. Well, charters say that freedom from regulation allows them to be innovative, but it also permits nepotism. And we have many, many examples of family members running charters, hiring family members, and giving contracts to family members. We have examples of conflicts of interest where board members sell their services to the school. And we have many examples of charter executives who receive exorbitant salaries of $300,000 a year, $400,000 a year or more, just to run one small school or a few small schools. Most of the charters are non-union. My guess is that at least 95% of them are non-union, possibly even more, because of their business model. Their business model is that they have young teachers, and therefore they have low teacher cost, and long work days and long work weeks. This somehow does not seem to be a sustainable model for American public education. And as Shanker feared, charters have now become, in many places, a stand-in for vouchers because they accomplish the same goal of getting the government out of public education and turning public dollars over to private control with minimal regulation. So there is a woman in Oakland, California, who runs a website called Charter School Scandals. It's a very big website with lots of stories. One from last fall had to do with a California principal who was indicted for having somehow lost $1 million. Now, one of the differences between a public school principal and a charter school principal is a public school principal will never see $1 million. So, in the competitive environment created by No Child Left Behind, charters have been incentivized to avoid students who might drag their scores down because they have to prove that they're better every year. Many of them have disproportionately small numbers of students who are English language learners, students who are immigrants, students with very strong disabilities. They tend to take the students with the mildest disabilities, and students who are homeless. Some charters achieve their high scores by pushing out low-achieving students and sending them back to public schools, which must accept them. I had a letter last fall from a principal in Los Angeles who said that every year, around the 1st of November, he gets 150 students from a nearby charter school, and they're all the lowest scoring students. And he said, they drag my scores down and their scores go up, and this isn't fair. Charters do everything that the corporate reform movement wants. They have no unions, they have performance pay, they can fire anyone they want at any time, and they should get astonishing results. This is the formula, but they don't. On average, study after study shows they get results no different from regular public schools. Some of them are, as I said before, some of them are excellent, some of them are really awful, and most are in the middle. One of the major studies done came out in 2009. It was done at Stanford University by, it's called the CREDO study. I forget what the center stands for. It's like the center for R-E-D-O, whatever that is. What the CREDO study showed, and it was funded by the Walton Family Foundation, the Walmart family, which is a very, very pro-charter, pro-choice, pro-voucher foundation. So everybody in the field expected it would come out favoring charters. But quite to everyone's surprise, it was It reached other results. It found that 17% of charters got better test scores in math than a matched neighborhood public school, 17%. 46% got results that were no different, and 37% got results that were worse. And this was a study that looked at half the charter schools in the nation. At that point, 2,400 charter schools. So about one out of six charter schools gets better results. The other 83% are either no different or worse. This doesn't seem like a wise investment of large amounts of state dollars. Then there was a study that came out just this past summer. It's posted on the website of the U.S. Department of Education. It's by Mathematica Policy Research. It studied middle school charters that hold lotteries. And what it found was that there was no difference between the middle school charters and regular middle schools, no advantage for the charters, not in terms of academics, nor in terms of student behavior. Charter students have been compared to regular public school students on the federal testing program since 2003. Federal tests are given every other year, so now we have tests in 03, 05, 07, and 09. The federal tests have never shown an advantage or difference between charters and regular public schools, not for black students, not for Hispanic students, not for urban students, and not for low-income students. Now, my hunch is, and possibly my hope, is that if charters were freed from this NCLB pressure to produce higher scores, they might be able to dedicate their efforts to students with the greatest needs. And they should, in fact, do that. They should be able to use their freedom to help students who have fallen behind. And maybe they could make a great contribution to American education if they could resume their original purpose. But it seems impossible with the federal law being what it is. So in 2008, during the presidential campaign, my guess is, from the polling data I've seen, that educators enthusiastically endorsed Barack Obama, believing that he would be the one to free schools from these bad ideas of No Child Left Behind. But it didn't happen. Instead, the Obama administration adopted the assumptions of No Child Left Behind, and if anything, has made them even worse. So the think tanks in the District of Columbia talk about a bipartisan consensus. It's a bipartisan consensus around very bad ideas. So the Obama program today is called the Race to the Top. Now, I guess that fundamentally it's offensive to think of education as a race to anywhere. You can go have a race to nowhere. You know, you can have a race to nowhere, a race to the bottom, a race to the top. What we're trying to accomplish in education, in American education, is a very simple principle. It's called equal educational opportunity. And that means that we have to care for every child and not say you're the winner and you're the loser. We're racing to the top. The most trenchant criticism of the Race to the Top program was contained in a brief created by six major civil rights organizations last summer. And they said that the idea of having a competition among the states was abhorrent because it was a retraction of the promise of federal aid to education. Federal aid to education was first passed in 1965, the general purpose, federal aid to education. And its purpose was to help the neediest children. Money was to go where the children were poor, wherever they were and whoever they were. So now instead we have a competition among the states. And the civil rights group said that means that most children get no federal aid at all from this program, and that's wrong. They also said, quoting Secretary Duncan, that if education is indeed a civil right, as you say it is, civil rights belong to individuals, not to states. And you can't have a competition for states and say that you're fulfilling the civil rights of children when most of them have no access to the funding. But in this case, it happens to be a good thing, for example, that California did not win the race to the top. So I congratulate you on your good fortune. Because the Race to the Top, which was $4.3 billion, which went to 11 states and the District of Columbia, first of all, superintendents have told me that it cost them far more to implement the program than the money they received. Superintendents in mid-sized districts, probably very much like your own, have told me that they might receive $60,000 over a four-year period and spend $300,000 to implement the mandates. So, you know, congratulations. But as I said, this program contains the worst aspects. First of all, it requires states to, in order to be eligible to compete, they had to lift their caps on charter schools, so there'll be many more privately managed schools. Secondly, the states had to agree to evaluate teachers by the scores of their students, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Third, they had to agree to incorporate elements of merit pay for teachers. And fourth, they had to agree to turn around failing schools. And so I'll talk about each of these things in turn. Race to the top, even more than No Child Left Behind, embodies the belief that students fail because they have bad teachers. Race to the top has unleashed a nationwide attack on teacher tenure, as well as efforts to link test scores and teachers' salaries and evaluations. Central Falls, Rhode Island, you may recall a year ago, which is the poorest district in all of Rhode Island. It's 19,000 people in great poverty, one high school. The superintendent there announced her intention to fire the entire staff of the high school, even the custodians and the lunchroom staff, even though no one had been evaluated. And Secretary Duncan applauded. And now, I read just last week that what the superintendent really managed to do, she said that this would usher in, she got a new labor contract, no one got fired, but 20% of the staff left, and another 15 to 20% is absent on any given day. What she managed to successfully do with the threats and the bullying was to demoralize the staff and break the bonds of trust that make a school function. Colorado passed a law called 191 to evaluate teachers by their test scores. Many other states are now doing that. At first, they did it to get Race to the Top money, and now their new governor is proposing legislation to eliminate teacher tenure and to base teacher evaluations on test scores, not to get the money, because it's not out there right now, but because they actually believe that teachers are the cause of low test scores. So, but the biggest problem today in the teaching profession is not getting rid of bad teachers, as waiting for Superman and Race to the Top would have you believe. It's holding on to teachers. Nationally, nationally, 50% of the people who enter teaching leave within 5 years. Some of them are fired, contrary to popular belief. Some of them leave because they discover that this is just not right for them. They don't feel that they're good at it. Some of them leave because they don't like the working conditions. But with all the various reasons, 50% are gone within 5 years. And with all this talk that we've had about getting rid of bad teachers, we've not paid enough attention to the importance of recruiting, retaining, and supporting those who enter teaching. One of the things that's bothered me about this idea of evaluating teachers by test scores is that it changes the whole power dynamic in the classroom. Imagine telling a group of students, or they will find this out very quickly, that if you don't get high scores, your teacher might be fired. Is that gonna make them work harder? They have the power to fire the teacher. This is insane. This destroys the whole, undermines the authority of the teacher, and it's not good. So on the question of merit pay, you should know, it has been tried again and again since the 1920s. It's one of those ideas that sounds so reasonable, but it's never worked. Supporters of merit pay said that the programs have failed in the past because the bonuses weren't big enough to motivate teachers. Just offering them $3,000 or $4,000 a year just wasn't enough to get them to really work harder. Now remember, the theory of this is if the teacher works harder, the students will work harder, but it's the students who have to do the work. But there's a missing link here, but let's not talk about that. So last fall, Vanderbilt University, the National Center on Performance Incentives, released the results of the most rigorous scientific test of merit pay ever conducted. The economist at this National Center on Performance Incentives designed an experiment in which middle school teachers were eligible to receive a bonus of $15,000 if their student scores went up. And at the end of a three-year period, having studied it every which way, the study concluded that there was no difference between teachers eligible for the bonus and teachers who were not eligible for the bonus. They got the same results. Merit pay made no difference. My hunch is that both groups of teachers were teaching the best they knew how. It didn't make a difference. So what do you think the supporters and advocates of merit pay said? The point was not to get higher test scores. It was to restructure the profession. Of course, you can't restructure the profession in a 3-year experiment, and they did expect to get higher test scores. That was the whole point of the experiment. But within a day or two, the U.S. Department of Education announced that it was awarding almost $500 million for merit pay programs across the country, because evidence doesn't matter. It pledged to add another $500 million for merit pay in the year ahead. This is not fiscally prudent. Merit pay has no evidence to support it. Good schools rely on collaboration among teachers and not competition for dollars. Now, about this matter of basing teacher evaluations and teacher pay on student test scores, you should know that most testing experts say that it's wrong to do this because test score gains and losses depend on factors that are mostly beyond the teacher's control, including the composition of the class, which is not random. Furthermore, the measures themselves, the studies show, are inaccurate and unstable. A teacher may get big gains one year and not the next, or vice versa. Good teachers will wrongly be identified as ineffective, and marginal teachers may be misidentified as effective. There is a huge margin of error. My colleague at New York University, economist Sean Corcoran, studied the value-added assessment programs in Houston and in New York City, and he gave an example. He said in New York City, a teacher may be told that she's at the 43rd percentile, meaning that 57% of teachers got higher test score gains, 43% got lower gains, and in fact, the margin of error is such that this exact same teacher might really be at the 71st percentile or the 15th percentile. So you would be quite accurate to describe this one teacher as average, above average, or below average, and you'd be right every time. Last week, I was at an event in New York City where a group of parents from across the country announced the formation of a new organization called Parents Across America. And one of the parents who was there, Sue Peters from Seattle, got up and said, "I do not want an effective teacher for my daughter." Effective means they get higher test scores. "I don't want an effective teacher," she said. "I want an inspiring teacher." "I want a brilliant teacher. I want a wise teacher. I want a teacher who cares about my daughter." And the test scores won't show any of that. So what this emphasis on test scores to evaluate teachers will do, and it's totally predictable, just like No Child Left Behind, it will promote teaching to the test. It will narrow the curriculum only to what is tested. There will be even less reason to teach non-tested subjects. Teachers will be incentivized to avoid low-income schools where the test score gains are harder to produce. This will harm the neediest children. The corporate reformers like to say, and they often say, that the teacher is solely responsible for test score gains and losses, but this is not true. Study after study has shown that the teacher is the most important factor within the school, but that the influence of the teacher is dwarfed by the influence of the family and the student. If the family supports the school and encourages the student, it makes a huge difference. If the student is not motivated and doesn't come to school regularly, that makes a huge difference. If the family is homeless, it matters. If there is one consistent finding in the social science literature of the past century, it is that test scores are closely correlated with family income. Poverty affects achievement. If a student comes from a family where the parents are educated and have a good income, he or she begins school with important advantages. If a student comes from a home where no one speaks English or from a neighborhood where crime and violence and unemployment are common, the student begins schools with significant disadvantages. Some students who are affluent will not succeed, and some students who grow up in poverty will succeed, but the odds are in favor of those with the economic advantages. Poverty does matter. In the United States, 20% of children are now living in poverty, and that number is going up. This is a scandal in the post-industrial world that we have so many children living in poverty. Poverty is associated, obviously, with homelessness, with ill health, with poor housing, with high mobility, economic insecurity of all kinds, and these things affect motivation, attitude, and attendance. So what about turning around failing schools? Well, of course, every state and every district should do whatever it can to help schools that have low test scores, should find out why their scores are low, and bring whatever resources and technical support are necessary to help them do better. But the No Child Left Behind remedies, which Obama and Duncan are preserving, have produced no results. And basically, it's four things. Turn the school over to the state, and I have yet to know of a state that's ever turned a school around. Turn them into charter schools, and the results will be what I've described. Some good, some bad, most no difference. Privatize them, fire the staff, or close them. Closing schools is a problem because I can understand why schools have to be closed for under-enrollment, but to close a school because test scores are low destroys social capital. One of the things we know from a lot of social science research is that school improvement, school reform, works best when there's collaboration among teachers and parents, administrators, members of the community, when children, no matter what their circumstances, are surrounded by adults who care about them, so that someone knows their name, if they get in trouble, they know who to call, and they are surrounded by the values and the ethics of people that they know. These are real social networks. When you close a school and you send kids out to schools of choice and you have, as in my area in New York City, 12 kids in the same building going to 12 different schools, it destroys social networks and destroys social capital. So I've wondered sometimes whether Chicago might be the model for this approach to turnaround schools. The program in Chicago was called Renaissance 2010. It was created 7 years ago by Mayor Richard Daley and Superintendent Arne Duncan, and they pledged that by the year 2010, Chicago would experience a renaissance in education. The business community put up $50 million. Foundations put up many more millions. They closed a lot of dozens of low-performing schools, and they replaced them with new schools. The only problem is it's 2011, and there has been no renaissance. The Chicago Tribune reported that scores in the new elementary schools are nearly identical to the city average, and scores at the new high schools are below the already abysmal city average. The Consortium on Chicago School Research, which is an independent group, found that more than 80% of the students from the closed schools transferred to other low-performing schools and made no gains. The business community, which had worked very closely to create Renaissance 2010, conducted its own review and concluded, quote, most of Chicago's students drop out or fail. The vast majority of Chicago's elementary and high schools do not prepare their students for success in college and beyond. Performance in the high schools, they said, was, quote, and unquote, abysmal. Half the students drop out, more than 70% fail to meet state standards, and the only high-performing schools in Chicago are those with selective admissions. But in the regular high schools, which serve the vast majority of students, quote, almost no students are prepared to succeed in college, unquote. So it turns out, and I've looked at some of these turnaround programs, it seems to be a booming business, lots of consultants making a lot of money coming to advise on turning around schools, although they themselves have never turned one around. But the most successful method of turning around a low-performing school is to get rid of the low-performing students. That actually works, but it's really not a good idea. That's not what we're about, is it? Most of the so-called failing schools are actually schools with large numbers of low-performing students. Unless you've evaluated the staff and found them wanting, it really doesn't do much good to fire the staff and bring in a whole new staff, which may also be wanting. What do we need to do? There are so many things we need to do. We should do what works. We should do what's proven. We should do what's cost-effective. First of all, we know that high-quality pre-kindergarten programs work. We know that it's important that children start school ready to learn. We know that there is already a large gap between children who enter kindergarten from homes of poverty and homes of affluence. Pre-K programs help to narrow that gap. So do programs aimed at children from birth to five. We need parent education programs. Yeah. so that parents can support and encourage their children and help the schools do their job. We need for every child to have access, if they need it, and if their parents can't afford it, to a medical clinic so that they're healthy and able to learn. We need more professionalism, not less. We need teachers who have entered the profession with high standards for coming into the profession, who have more support when they enter teaching, who have good working conditions so that they can remain teachers and continue to get better every year. I mentioned Finland earlier as a country that regularly has done very well on the international assessments. Sometimes I wonder if we should worry about the Finns dominating the world. They're so good. Finland doesn't have standardized testing in their schools. They don't take tests in Finnish schools until they apply to college. Otherwise, they have teacher-made tests because they have put their investment and their focus on having the best possible teachers in their classrooms and trusting them. We need professional teachers, not people who come and go and intend to come and go. We need master teachers to become principals. It has become very voguish recently to have people from industry, from the military, and from sports take a short training program and then become principals. I think they should teach first. The most important job that a principal has, especially in this environment and for years to come, will be to help and evaluate teachers. If you've never taught yourself, you can't do the most important job you have. Thirdly, our superintendents should be expert educators. There is a program that's sponsored by one of the major foundations, the Broad Foundation in Los Angeles, where they train urban superintendents who've never been teachers or principals. I recently met someone who is a public relations consultant who was training to be an urban consultant, a superintendent, and I thought it very odd because she'd never worked in education before. But I think that, you know, if you think about it, the superintendent is the one who has to make the critical decisions about what curriculum, what's good instruction in our district, how to deploy resources, the human capital decisions, and also just the crucial issues that arise every day that comes to a superintendent's desk, especially in this environment, where to cut, who to cut, how to cut. Those decisions should be made not by a manager, but by an educator who knows how to hurt children the least. We certainly need better assessments. We need more frequent writing assignments, more science projects, more history research projects, more comprehension, and fewer bubble tests. And we should have, every child should have a balanced curriculum in every grade. Every child should have the arts and science and history and civics and geography and literature and foreign languages and physical education and health. I've been told in some states that physical education is now being offered as a virtual subject. Can you imagine? Instead of playing team sports, you go home and put on a DVD and you exercise in front of it? A balanced curriculum of the kind I've described is what people do when they can afford to spend anything. It also happens to be what the world's highest performing nations do, and it's what we should do. Every state should send teams of expert educators to low-performing public schools to diagnose the problems, to make recommendations, and to stay involved and make sure that help will be available and the changes will be implemented. Now, what I've portrayed to you is a somewhat, I would say, dire picture. I think it's an accurate picture. This is the scenario that I see. But I think there are signs of hope. I'm very impressed with the new state superintendent of education that California just elected, Tom Torlakson. I was very pleased to see that your new governor brought on 5 educators to the State Board of Education. I think that's a great thing. And while he may be forced to make cuts, and he will make cuts, he will not do it as some governors are doing gleefully, but sadly and reluctantly, because he knows it's a terrible thing to cut education. And I see signs of hope in what I see as a growing backlash, if you want to call it that. Teachers are organizing. Teachers are sitting in the Wisconsin State Capitol tonight. I expect they'll be sitting in lots of state capitals because the move to strip teachers of their right to have a voice is spreading to many states, and teachers will be active. A group of national board certified teachers have started a movement to have a march on Washington, and this July, they've created an organization with a website called SaveOurSchoolsMarch.org. It's being led by an Oakland teacher, a science teacher named Anthony Cody, and he has gotten teachers from across the country to join with him, and they're reaching out to teachers everywhere to say, join us in Washington, let's show the world that we will stand up for the dignity of our profession and try to roll back the things I've been describing to you tonight. Parents, the ones I was earlier referring to, parents across America have started a new group to resist high-stakes testing and to resist the movement towards privatizing public education. I think that the research community is going to help turn the tide, not because they're activists, but because they do careful research. And even those who may be ideologically in favor of some of these things continue to come out with findings that don't support the agenda that I've described. The public is with us. The latest Gallup poll, or the one from last fall, asked people, how do you rate American public education? Now remember, people have been bombarded now for years with tales of how terrible everything is. And so 18% give American public schools an A or a B. But when I ask, rate the school that your child attends, the number goes to 77%. This is the highest figure ever recorded since Gallup has been asking this question. 77% give their own child's school, which they know, an A or a B. They like their children's teachers. A poll just came out this afternoon, a Gallup poll. No, it's not Gallup, it's CNN poll, asking the public, do you think the teachers should have the right to belong to unions? 61% said yes. And I wrote some articles on CNN.com about the Wisconsin situation and got just a barrage of angry mail from, well, lots of letters from teachers saying thank you, but also some very nasty letters about those lazy teachers, they don't deserve to be paid, we should fire them all, sort of thing. And then one of the commenters on this CNN poll said, when they saw that it was 61% to 31%, said, it seems that there are a small number of people making an awful lot of noise about teachers and not appreciating the hard work that teachers do. This public, I think, wants a strong public school system. If they have children, they don't want to enter them in a lottery. They want to have a school that they can send their children to and not be turned away. So now it's up to you. It's up to you because we live in a democracy. I've been to Washington, I've talked to congressmen, I've talked to senators, I've talked to people in the White House. They don't know how people in their communities feel. They don't know how negatively people view high-stakes testing. They need to hear from you. You need to write them, you need to speak to them. If you're an educator, you need to bring business people into your schools. You need to bring civic leaders into your schools. You need to invite them to walk in your shoes for a day or a couple of days. Let them know the kinds of problems you deal with and enlist their support. We have no choice in this country if we want to be a great nation, but to continue to maintain and strengthen and support a strong public school system. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. If you give us a quick second, we will set up for the question and answer period, and we will go right into it. So they just have to take the podium off stage and bring out the chairs. And if you'd like to, if you raise your hand with the cards, the ushers will pick up the cards if you have questions. They will be picking them up. Very good. Thank you very much. Loved it. Phyllis is picking up questions over there, and we have someone on this side. I think Linda's over here with questions. We just have to bring the water on and we'll be ready.
Where is Dr. Denton? Where's Luke?
He's right over there. He's
from the university. So we bring the water on. We'd like to welcome our faculty host for the evening. He is our Lawton Love Distinguished Professor in Special Education, and he was actually very instrumental in getting Diane here. I recommended her earlier last year. So please welcome Dr. Lou Denty, who will take care of the question and answer period. Stage is all yours, Lou.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Boy, it's bright. Well, I think there's some questions coming down from the ushers, but I have a question to start off with Dr. Ravitch. We had a chance to talk briefly, but I'd like her response to this. You wrote two opinion pieces in response to what Governor Scott Walker of Wisconsin is currently proposing. The first piece was Why America's Teachers Are Enraged, and the second piece was To My Critics, Teachers Deserve Rights. Why did you write these opinion pieces, and what kind of response have you received from teachers and others?
Mm-hmm. Well, I was in Denver and Tucson last week, and as I was about to leave Denver, I got an email from an editor at CNN inviting me to write an article about what was happening in Wisconsin. So I did not just the issues in Wisconsin, but sort of put it in this very briefly the context of what I described tonight about how teachers are so tired of the vilification that they've been subject to over the past couple of years about only teachers cause low test scores and on with state legislatures passing very hostile legislation. And something amazing happened. The article came out on Saturday, Why America's Teachers Are Enraged. And then they contacted me from CNN and they said they had something like 37,000 shares to Facebook. And this was one of the most shared articles they've ever run. And there were over 8,000 comments. Now, my website has my email on it, and I got a couple of hundred emails. And many of them were from teachers saying thank you for sticking up for us, but a number of them were just insanely angry at teachers. They were angry because teachers have pensions. They were angry because teachers have health care. They said, I don't have health care, why should teachers? I don't have a pension, why should teachers? And just going on in a very hostile way. So then I realized very soon after the article was published that there were no financial issues on the table. I read in the Monday New York Times that the union, without any negotiations, had agreed to all of the governor's financial demands. So I wrote a response and I said, there are no financial issues on the table. This is purely about whether teachers have the right to be represented in collective bargaining. And so once again, I got a whole barrage of hate mail, but also some great letters from teachers. And I think that we're seeing this kind of attack on teachers' right to bargain collectively across the country. Many states have no collective bargaining. Their right to work states. When I was in Arizona the other day, I was told that the starting salary for teachers is $26,000, and that the state spends around $5,500 a student. It's one of the lowest in the country. It might be 50th. I think when you don't have an organized force to go to the legislature and fight for funding for schools, that people can cut and cut and cut, and you have to be able to stand up for schools, and with no one's saying that the Chamber of Commerce can't lobby. No one's saying that the tech companies can't lobby or that the corporations can't lobby. Everybody can lobby, apparently, except teachers. So I think that it's important to have voices who defend teachers' right to have an organized voice.
Thank you. I have a question from the audience. How do we protect public education from predatory for-profit Trojan horses like K-12 Incorporated, a Michael Milken venture? Can we incorporate online classes while protecting our schoolhouses?
Well, this is a very major question because there is now a move on. One of the emails I got just this afternoon came from Utah, where the business community there is behind a plan where the governor wants to cut 770 teachers and replace them with online learning. And they're polling the public, and the poll goes like this: do you support education reform, yes or no? I think they're calling it something like students come first. I've discovered that anytime someone says children first or students come first or it's for the kids, watch out. That's always but how can we protect against them? I think, it requires an organized voice to say children need teachers. They need somebody who will look into their eyes and who will give them encouragement or whose support they want, whose approval they want. I've been told by my friends who went to Catholic school that the most powerful motivator was not fear of the nuns, but the desire to please the nuns. And you don't have to worry about pleasing the computer. You know, it'll say hooray for you no matter what you do, or it'll say go back and do it again, but you don't worry about its approval. But I think that there are a lot of people who now look on education as great entrepreneurial venture. And if you put the words education and entrepreneur into Google, you will come out with many, 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 many hits, because this is a big sector that looks on the education industry as a source of profit. And it's not going to be good for education. I just don't see, as I look around the world, I don't see any country that's doing this as we are. And we can't let them get away with it.
Well, I have a question regarding the Chicago public schools. Did Arne Duncan really improve Chicago public schools? Recent statistics raise serious doubts that actually happened.
Well, you know, I have not seen a study that suggests that Chicago schools were improved over these past several years. They picked up a few points on the national assessment, but so did every other urban district. And when you look at the studies that actually examine the effect of all these school openings, closings, new schools, charter schools, and I didn't even mention Catalyst. Catalyst is a research magazine in Chicago whose report on Renaissance 2010 summed it up as mediocre test scores, high teacher turnover in charter schools, and shaky budgets in both sectors. That's the result of Renaissance 2010. I mean, the sad thing is, and I think he's a very amiable man, I just don't think Chicago is a good model for the country, because it has not shown the kind of progress by any measure that I've seen that we would want for the rest of the country. And even if it showed great test scores, I would still want to know, what do those scores mean? Do they mean that children are prepared for college? Do they mean that they leave high school well-educated? I mean, we've turned scores into some kind of a substitute for achievement, and they're not. They're just scores.
Excellent response. What advice would you give to parents who seek to preserve the endangered concept of the neighborhood school? Just as the middle class is under attack, so is the neighborhood school via reform.
I think this is a connect the dots moment. And there are a lot of very powerful people who, you know, maybe I said it earlier to the students, there are some of them who mean well and some of them who just see money, and some of them who want power and control. But the end result of their joint action, which is privatization and deprofessionalization, will not be good for any of us. So I think that this is a time where we have to have grassroots democracy, let our elected officials know very strongly how we feel, and organize.
I think we're going to go back to Finland now, all right? Here's a question. How does the Finnish school decide who are the best teachers? Do you have some data on that?
There's no data, because they don't care. Everybody that they bring into teaching is the best teacher. That what they have is a culture of collaboration where teachers are trusted, where they work together. I'll give you a, an anecdote. A man who is the head of the Schott Foundation for Public Education in Boston went to Finland and several other countries, and wherever he went, he would ask the question of, what do you do about bad teachers? And they said to them, well, we give them help. And he said, well, what if you give them help and they're still bad teachers? And they said, well, then they need more help. But I would assume that in Finland they have such good training. First of all, they select. They have many people applying to become teachers, and that not everyone who wants to be a teacher can become a teacher. And then they're selective in the first place, and then they have a rigorous program of education and preparation and mentoring and support, and they believe they're all professionals. How do we know who the best doctors are? How do we know who the best lawyers are? This is a collaborative enterprise, and I don't think there's a ranking system. I think that we have to stop thinking that, you know, this is not baseball or the stock market. This is education. Who's the best person in your department? You?
Well, we don't talk about it.
Okay. I mean, who's the best mother on your block? Who's the best member of your family? I mean, come on.
Well, I can talk about it a little bit. I'm Italian, and I know who's the best one in my, it's my mother. Okay. What does the research say about the best way to bring the English language level of English learners up and also give them a balanced curriculum? We have a tremendous number of English language learners in the Tri-County area here.
Well, I'm a historian, and I think I would be out of my depth if I started talking about that. I really don't tell people how to teach.
Okay.
Practice, practice, practice.
Fair enough. Okay. All right. How do you build social capital within communities and schools so that children can succeed?
Well, I was actually quoting a book by Anthony Bright, who's now the president of the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching. It's called Organizing Schools for Improvement, and he compared a group of schools that did reform to a group of schools that didn't reform, and they were both equally poor. And he had several key elements, some of which are sort of obvious, about having a strong principal and a strong curriculum. But the one thing that stuck in my mind was that issue about the connection among teachers and the administrators and the community and the parents, and all of them kind of gathered together around the needs of students. And it does have to do with grassroots organizing, starting at the school. And every school that I think is successful, well, I won't say every school, because it works differently in different neighborhoods, but I think particularly where there is a community where there are a lot of high needs, there has to be a kind of something to hold it together. And I think that people can bond together and help each other around the needs of children.
It's been my observation that oftentimes we don't capitalize on the strengths of the community. And we don't use that and value that and bring that into the schools. It takes a concerted effort and powerful leadership in order to do that.
Yes. Well, I know that a lot of times schools will have trouble even getting parents to come for a parent evening. Mm-hmm. But then you have to think of better ways to bring parents in, maybe by doing culturally relevant things or asking them to what they're good at and bringing them in ways that make them feel welcome.
I think that's an excellent suggestion, and I found that to be true, that when that does happen, it really is powerful. And it's engaging. If not through standardized tests, how can we as a nation best measure educational progress?
Well, we have the NAEP, and that's one way of measuring, and it's a sampling basis. We don't have to measure every single child every single year. And the problem is, as I was trying to say in my talk, is not testing per se, it's using testing for rewards and punishments.
Right.
And if you use testing diagnostically, so that in a school you can say, well, clearly Johnny didn't learn the following things. Let's sit around the table together and talk about how we can help Johnny with these specific issues that he has, or Maria with the specific issues she has, or identify things that the teacher needs to do a better job of. But then not take those same measures and say, now you get a bonus, or now I'm going to cut your pay. Because then you begin to distort the purpose of the, you distort the test as a measure, because then everyone starts focusing on the test and forgets about Johnny being a person.
I agree. I saw a bumper sticker that said, high stakes are for tomatoes. and that resonated with me, and you've addressed some of it tonight. And it certainly creates a tremendous imposition on teachers, and it's been a difficult time for them. And I appreciate what the comments that you shared with us. I have a question of my own. President Obama indicates that we need an educated workforce for the 21st century. Intel and the Intel Foundation have invested $1 billion towards improving education. Will it take a concerted effort, a true partnership between business and public education to achieve an educated workforce? So I want you to address the notion of an educated workforce and some of your thoughts on that.
Well, I would rather think in terms not of an educated workforce, but of an educated citizenry. I think, I mean, I understand where the president's coming from, and, you know, he talked in his State of the Union about how we need imagination, creativity, and innovation, and yet all the policies I've described tonight crush imagination, creativity, and innovation. So the question is, do we want people who can go into the workforce and come up with new ideas, or do we want them just to be able to operate machinery that won't even exist 10 years from now? And be prepared to find the right answer out of four possibles. I mean, this is not going to lead to the kind of thinking person you want on the job. But I think that just to think of jobs is too narrow, because frankly we don't know what the jobs of the future will look like. So what we need to do is to think of young people as creative, thinking, imaginative beings who giggle and smile and cry, and who need personal development, who need to have someone who's going to reinforce lessons about their character, about who's going to help them grow in their knowledge of the world, who's going to teach them about science and encourage them to explore and to use their imagination to come up with fresh ways of seeing things, not just to have one of four choices. So if we think of citizens and we think of character, then the workforce stuff will fall into place. Because we don't know what this is what I've learned from studying American education over the past 150 years. People are always saying, I'm going to train people for the jobs right now. But by the time they get into the workforce, those jobs are gone. They don't even exist anymore. They were training people to make baskets and shoe horses, and automobiles were being invented. Now, so we really need a kind of a flexible kind of approach to education, where maybe the most important thing you can do is to learn to play a musical instrument. Because I'm not saying this frivolously, I'm saying it with envy, because my mother didn't make me do it. Because if you learn to play a musical instrument, it requires tremendous discipline. You can't just get out there and scratch away on with a bow. You have to really practice and practice and practice and take it seriously. This is a tremendous kind of self-discipline. And if you get to be good enough at it, you can do it in a group.
Here's another question from the audience. Can you talk about some effective schools you have seen in your travels around the country?
You know, it's harder and harder to find. I mean, I don't even like to use the word effective anymore. I'd say that the schools that I've seen that I've liked were ones where kids were asked to write a lot, where they were asked to read and come up with their own ideas and express things in their own words, and where there was an environment of adults who worked together as colleagues. But this is getting to be harder and harder, because we have created in this country this environment where the only thing that matters are your scores. And so this is the challenge, and it's very hard, because I can't tell you right now, I can't lay out a roadmap and say, if we do the following four things, we can roll back No Child Left Behind. But we do, I continue to believe, there are, you know, the U.S. Senate, you have two senators from California, you have lots of congressmen, the leading Democratic senator on the Education Committee is a strong supporter of No Child Left Behind. He helped to write it, George Miller. Mm-hmm. Go get him.
I really was impressed with your thought about having our legislators actually spend some time in their schools and our corporate business heads spend a day or two. And your thought was that that would really change their minds, that they would empathize with what a teacher does on a daily basis, on how hard they work. and the challenges they face every day?
Well, the challenges they face, but also the challenges that many of the kids face. Last week when I was, I get these great emails right before I speak, and I got an email from a teacher who I think was going to come here tonight. Maybe he's going to be in Santa Clara tomorrow night. But this teacher wrote, and he published a letter that was all over the internet, and he teaches somewhere near here. And he said that he has 30 kids in his class. Most of them are 10. Some of them are 11 because several of them have been held back. And he said seven of his kids are in special ed. Two or three others ought to be in special ed and are not. 10 of the kids in his class don't have parents because they live with an older brother or grams. He just described what these kids live with, the tragedies and the violence in their lives. And he said, he was writing a letter to the president, and he said, you and Secretary Duncan say that poverty doesn't matter. Don't you know that I am living with pure, raw poverty? These kids are growing up in third world conditions in our country. Come to my school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's important. When we write our legislators, let's encourage them to do so.
He also mentioned, by the way, that his school has not had an art or music teacher for 10 years.
Yeah.
That's a disgrace in a country, as wealthy as this, where foundations can throw billions of dollars around, and yet we can't provide a basic, decent education for all of our kids. Yeah.
What advantages, if any, do you see in augmenting vocational programs, especially for students who are not college-bound? In the second part to this question, what do you see as the elements of a positive, constructive teacher evaluation system?
The first one is, tell me the first one again, because okay. I'm getting very bad at this as I get old.
What advantages, if any, do you see in augmenting vocational programs?
Yeah, vocational.
Okay.
This is the point I would make about that. Finland, which I've been holding up tonight as some sort of paragon, 40% of their high school students are in career and technical programs, and they're not going to go to college. And they're not doing low-level vocational stuff. They're preparing for jobs that exist right now that are well-paying jobs that are in the tech sector. They have a tremendous tech society in Finland, and they're not embarrassed to say 40% of our kids are not heading to college. This is of their own free will. If they want to transfer back into the college program, they can anytime. How do you evaluate teachers? The most important and best way to evaluate teachers is to have an experienced principal who evaluates teachers, who goes into their classroom, who observes them, who sees the quality of the student work in their classroom, and who sees them enough to be able to say no if they need help or if they're good. And if they need help, he or she can provide help.
Well, I think we're ready to close this evening with questions asked. But let me share a couple things with you. I love your passion, the insights that you were able to share with us, and your open-mindedness. I really do appreciate everything you've been doing. You're a real champion of teachers and education. And we at CSUMB and our greater community appreciate you so much for being here this evening.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. That is so great. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you, Dr. Denti, Lou Denti, for suggesting this magnificent speaker. You've given us a lot to think about and a lot of inspiration. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
If you want to meet our speaker, there is a book signing in the lobby right now. Thank you.